Just give them due for approval. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Pass unanimously. Now I have some public hearings conducted by Councilor Whitaker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our first public hearing is the Greenville Anderson Walker County Industrial Business Park Agreement Amendment, Project LEWA and LAD. This public hearing has been held for the purpose of receiving public comments regarding an ordinance to amend an agreement for the development of the joint county industrial and business park, 2010 park, of Anderson and Greenville County so as to enlarge the park. Mrs. Kaiser, has anyone signed up to speak either in favor or in opposition?
No, sir.
Anyone here tonight would like to speak in favor of this? Anyone like to speak in opposition? If not, I declare this public hearing closed. The next public hearing is Tower Automotive Operations USA One LLC, formerly Project Rampart. This public hearing is being held for the purpose of receiving public comments regarding an ordinance pursuant to Chapter 44 of Title 12, Code of Laws of South Carolina, 1976, as amended to enter into a fee agreement between Greenville County, South Carolina, Tower Automotive Operations USA One LLC, and Stone Mountain Industrial Park Incorporated, providing for payment of fees in lieu of taxes and certain special source revenue credits against the same and matters relating thereto. Mrs. Kaiser, has anyone signed up to speak either in favor or in opposition?
Yes, sir.
Is anyone here that would like to speak in favor of this? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Hearing none, I declare this public hearing closed. Our next public hearing is Tower Automotive Operations USA One LLC, formerly Project Rampart. This public hearing is being held for the purpose of receiving public comments regarding an ordinance to amend an agreement for the development of a joint county industrial and business park, 2010 park, of Anderson and Greenville County so as to enlarge the park. Mrs. Kaiser, has anyone signed up to speak either in favor or in opposition?
No, sir.
Would anyone like to speak in favor of this? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Hearing none, I declare this public hearing closed. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. All right, now we come to a time when citizens can make appearances before the council to discuss current agenda items. I understand that there are numbers signed up for Mrs. Kaiser, for the resolution.
We have nine citizens signed up to speak on the resolution regarding refugees.
All right. There are nine people signed up, and they're all on the same topic. You, in order to save time, you might want to have a, appoint somebody to speak for you, but you can call the first name. By the way, when you cover the podium, please state your name and address, and then you're confined to 3 minutes, and there will be a time limit to tell my questions. All right. First person, Mrs. Kaiser.
Christina Shepherd.
All right.
Thank you very much for allowing me to speak. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
I want to address the refugee situation. Christina Jeffrey, 801 Palmetto Street, Spartanburg, South Carolina. We have been dealing with this issue in Spartanburg for quite some time, and we are, we're very grateful that Spartanburg has finally written to Nikki Haley and asked her to suspend her acceptance of Syrians. But the truth is that the FBI has identified all failed states as problematic for vetting refugees. Secondly, none of the people coming here through World Relief are actually refugees. A refugee is somebody who goes to a safe country and seeks refuge. Once they leave that safe country, they're migrants. But we are picking and choosing from the pool of refugees and bringing them here. Also, the way that these people are vetted when they come from failed states, we're told these are the most vetted people in the world. Certainly not true, because they have no way of officially vetting them, what they do is they ask them to tell their stories. And they tell their stories to State Department officials. This comes from the meeting of Ann Richard to citizens in Spartanburg. And if the stories are persuasive, then they are believed. And if the stories are not persuasive, they're not believed. And I just simply, in my experience as a teacher, have found that honest people don't always tell the best stories. The best stories are often from the guy who explains to you what happened to his homework. Sometimes that can be very imaginative, not the truth. And if I have any time left, I'd like to respond to the narrative that Jason Lee tells about welcoming the stranger and doing the biblically correct thing. I wonder if World Relief is prepared to protect these Muslim immigrants from the effects of being evangelized, because if they are successfully evangelized, they may be killed. And also to protect the people in the churches who do the evangelizing. There are very strict Sharia laws. As long as the Muslims are in the minority, they don't act on that law. But when they become a majority, they do. And they're liable to remember those evangelizers. Thank you very much.
My name is Patricia Cullen. I live at 311 off the lane in Malden. And I just wanted to thank every one of you, each one of you who worked on this. Got it together so that you have the resolution today. It really meant a lot to me. I'm almost in tears now, but I've been in joy, almost jumping up and down since I heard that y'all are going to do this today. Thank you again so much.
Council members and fellow citizens, other refugees coming in. Last meeting, Mr. Lee, from World Relief, said that the people that he was bringing in were supposedly coming from Burma. I did some research in Burma, which is now called Malamar. They're predominantly Buddhist. The only refugees that are coming out of Burma are Sunni Muslims. The Christians and the Jewish people that all get along with the Buddhists primarily in that country. So any refugees that he said were coming in there, he made another true statement research that I've done. Also from the 20s until the 60s, the United States did not accept any refugees. They had to have a visa or they had to have work, proof that they had work to come into this country. We did not take any because it would protect the United States citizens. And I'm glad to see that in the resolution that were passed, and you said foreign refugees, which would cover anybody that would be coming in here. And today, foreign businesses, Mr. Burns said about coming in here in our county, they can get visas or work visas for people to come in to work in them companies, that they do not have to come in as refugees. They come, they can bring them in on work visas. And as for Middle East refugees, why is not Saudi Arabia, Egypt, or any accepting any of these? Saudi Arabia has one of the largest refugee camps in the world, and there is no refugees there. It sits empty. They can handle 100,000 people in there, and the camp sits empty. And then we're getting food, people getting aid and food stamps. We have in this country alone, our own citizens, we have 94 million getting some sort of federal aid. Now, why does our citizens have to get federal aid, and they're bringing in more citizens and paying them our tax dollars to pay them, which I like the resolution where it said that no South Carolina money going for their aid. If they cannot have their own way of taking care of themselves, providing for themselves, just like ancestors did in the early days, they took care of themselves. We do not need any more foreign aid or any refugees coming in here. And as in France, you see, it only takes 8 or 9 can hurt millions or even thousands of people, depending on what they do. We have the nuclear clients. All it takes is 1 or 2 to come in there and blow one of them, and you can wipe out the whole northeast section of the state of South Carolina. You go to York County and wipe out Charlotte. You go to Charleston, they're right next to the military base. So it only takes 5 or 6. It doesn't take 2 or 3, you know, 100,000. You only need 5 or 6. If 5 or 6 come in and have refugees, they can hurt thousands or hundreds or thousands and thousands of U.S. citizens. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to address the council. My name is Diane Hardy. I live at 104 Tully Drive, Anderson, South Carolina. And I just thought what we saw tonight was just a beautiful demonstration of how a republic is supposed to function. Contrary to what they keep teaching our children in school, that we live in a democracy, as you know, we live in a republic, which means that the citizens are supposed to be engaged throughout the year, not just on the day that we vote. And so tonight, to have the citizens engaged and to have you all reflecting the will of the citizens, which often doesn't happen in government, is just beautiful. And I want to thank you, and cannot even be in their best interest. Lots of times when they come here, they're miserable and they want to go back and they can't get home. So I'd like to, hopefully, we'll, as a country, we'll explore other options. But thank you so much tonight for listening to the people. And it's great to feel like you can participate in your government in a republic as our founders envisioned. Thank you.
Coming into our country or North America. The thing is about one world religion. The thing is about the TRRR program where Obama goes into Ghana and he gathers up all the refugees and picks out the brightest and best. But by then the Christians are already murdered, according to a missionary doctor that I talked to in town. That's why there's no Christians in refugees. Also, we have what's called the Liberty Fellowship International, the Liberty Fellows, the Liberty Fellow. There's top secret job positions that are moving in this big cover-up, I believe. I'm like an Aaron Brockovich for 2015. The Aspen Roundtable Institute trains the Liberty Fellowship, South Carolina, Florida, Indiana, all over the nation. The Aspen Roundtable Institute teaches Socratic Roundtable religion. It teaches Dalai Lama, His Holiness, his partner. It teaches about other international multicultural faiths. They are going to hit the ports all over North America. Why? Because the imams want to inbred and rape girls and put the blood of Allah into them to spread the Allah religion, the Islam religion. Why aren't they in Saudi Arabian camps? Because the MERS virus started in 2012. Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome spread like crazy. Starting in Saudi Arabia. They don't even want these people. Greenville Hospital System posted a sign in their OB/GYN clinic about MERS to warn the nurses and doctors if they have traveled in the Middle East in September. Why in September? Because that's the peak for H-2B visas. Liberty Fellowship International, Bill Gates, Payne Hip, has infiltrated all of South Carolina, from the governors to the ports, especially the port authorities, and that's how I got involved, because of the South Carolina Inland Port. The Haitian Mission Project and different boxcars have come through the Inland Port. In conclusion, Obama's campaign director was a Liberty Fellowship graduate. It's a class. It's prestigious. It's the in crowd. The movers and shakers. I have three Navy kids. Benjamin Carson from Johns Hopkins operated and opened my daughter's brain and spine, but he's a Liberty Fellowship fellow. An Indian doctor delivered my first baby. I have nothing against India. I do have something against Liberty Fellowship funneling monies into India.
I would ask you to end your remarks, please.
My remarks about refugees. I do not want one penny of my dollars, my tax paychecks, going into this organization.
Ma'am?
I'm sorry?
Your time is up.
Okay. Like I said, I'm sorry. I wasn't trained at the Aspen Institute or public speaking. I apologize, sir.
Thank you.
Refugees, we don't need any right now, unless they're missionaries from Christian countries that preach the word of God. Our founding fathers, they came here under persecution from European religious groups, and it was natural for the early Americans to turn to the Bible for guidance as to how to make civil law. This was the standard for law, beginning with the Mayflower Compact, all the way through the constitutions of all 50 states. By the way, what was the stated purpose of the Pilgrims as expressed in the Mayflower Compact? Contrary to revisionist history, their purpose was not to find religious freedom. They already had found religious freedom in Holland. Their purpose is clearly stated as being for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith. That's biblical Christian faith. The Pilgrims were missionaries. That's what this country was founded on. To spread the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the Word of God, it says, whoever transgresses and abides not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. People are going to hell everywhere. These refugees are not bringing the message of salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ, and how in faith alone, in His blood that He shed on that cross, and His death, burial, and resurrection, faith alone in that will get a person into heaven. We've been persecuted for countless centuries for preaching that. 50 million people died at the hands of religious authorities in Europe in the Middle Ages. And these people coming with Islamic views, anything goes with them. They're not of God, they're the devil. They're Luciferians, and Obama preaches a Luciferian doctrine, as do most of our leaders today. And when you take the Word of God and go back and look and see, it's always been a history of helping people that need help and that deserve help. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles 19:2, shouldst thou help the wicked and love them that hate the Lord? God will bring us down for helping people that hate our Jesus and preach a different gospel, and are here to change us to an Islamic fundamentalist nightmare. But an important aspect of our system of government is that it is based on the rule of law. This concept is a direct descendant of the Hebrew law and the Ten Commandments. Together with the concept of unalienable rights from God, these concepts help ensure a way of life that respected the dignity of every individual. This government was formed as a self-governing, representative government with Christian emphasis only, and not anything else. and the multiculturalism, the diversity, and all these crowds that say, well, my religion is as valid as yours, that's just not so according to what God says. If you transgress, you do not go to hell. Thank you for your time.
Gwen Hicks.
My name is Gwen Hicks Williams, and I reside at 511 Hall Lane, Greenville. I want you to know that I am opposed to bringing into the country, and especially into the upstate of South Carolina, any refugees from the Middle East, including any third world countries that have been infiltrated by Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Hamas, or any of the terror organizations that have taken up residence in these areas. The same type of events that we witnessed in Paris this past week could be, and should, will probably be, coming to a theater near us if we don't take action now to stop the refugee resettlement program. We are all blessed to know freedom in this country. I want my grandson to know the same thing that we know. I don't want him to grow up and the only thing he knows about freedom is a word in a dictionary. I thank you for standing with the community.
Good evening. My name is Scott Hicks. I reside at 511 Hall Lane, Greenville, South Carolina. I served 10 years in the United States Army, 3 combat tours to the Middle East, and a lot of my brothers lost their lives over there. Most importantly, I'm a father of a 7-year-old son, whom my mother just mentioned. He deserves to have a safe home, a safe school, and a safe future. I am opposed to allowing refugees into our nation and state, especially refugees from Middle Eastern nations that have been infiltrated by ISIS or any other terrorist organization. Our world is at war, whether you like to admit it or not. What better way for one of these organizations to infiltrate our country than by posing as a helpless refugee? We don't need to invite terror to our doorstep. Thank you.
Consent agenda, what is your pleasure?
Approval of consent agenda.
All right, we'll move for approval of consent agenda. All right.
Do it now.
Will you take off consent agenda and put a request of motion? All right. You can take it, what you want to do?
I just want to test.
All right.
I don't support the recommendation.
All right. It'll appear then in the committee reports have determined that. All right. Next item is resolutions, and
two resolutions in the Finance Committee. First resolution, Bosch Intellectual Corporation Project Titan. I move for adoption of resolution authorizing under certain conditions the execution and delivery by Greenville County, South Carolina of a special source revenue credit agreement with Bosch Rexroth Corporation with respect to a manufacturing, testing, and product proving grounds facility in the county whereby the project would be subject to payment of certain fees in lieu of tax and reimbursement of investment in related qualified infrastructure and providing for related matters.
All right, any discussion on this resolution? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thanks, sir. Our second resolution is also from the Finance Committee, Bosch Rexroth Corporation Project Titan Extension Resolution. I move for adoption of a resolution approving the extension by Greenville County, South Carolina of a fee agreement by and among Bosch Rexroth Corporation in Greenville County, South Carolina pursuant to the provisions of South Carolina Code annotated section 12-44-30 parenthesis 13 closed parenthesis code of laws of South Carolina 1976 is amended.
All Any discussion? All in favor of the resolution, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, now we have ordinance as a third reading, and the first one is zoning ordinance, Mr. Dill.
CZ 2015-59, property of Oceana Rapid LLC, located at 1320 Hampton Avenue Extension, requesting rezoning from I-1 to S-1. I move for adoption at third reading.
All right, you've heard the motion. Any discussion? All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously. All right, Mr. Kirby, some...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is going to take a lot of reading, and it's not very exciting material. Bear with me, and I hope my voice holds up, but we've been pretty busy on economic development matters. So first item is Tower Automotive Operations USA 1 LLC, formerly Project Rampart, fee in lieu of tax agreement. I move, let me get to my right place here. I move for adoption at third reading. An ordinance pursuant to Chapter 44, Title 12, Code of Laws of South Carolina 1976, has amended to enter into a fee agreement between Greenville County, South Carolina, Tower Automotive Operations USA 1 LLC and Stone Mountain Industrial Park, providing for payment of fees in lieu of taxes and certain special source revenue credits against the same and matters relating thereto.
All right, you've heard the ordinance. All in favor, or any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Item 9C, Tower Automotive Operations USA 1 LLC, formerly Project Rampart, Greenville-Anderson County Multi-County Industrial Business Park Agreement Amendment. I move for adoption at third reading and ordinance to amend the agreement for the development of a joint county industrial and business park, 2010 park, of Anderson and Greenville counties, so as to enlarge the park.
Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously.
Item 9D, Hospitality Tax Amendment, Cancer Survivors Park. I move for adoption at third reading and ordinance to amend Exhibit A, established as an addendum to Ordinance 4079, as last amended by Ordinance 4686, so as to appropriate additional operating funds for tourist-related projects.
All right, any discussion of the ordinance? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
All right, the vote is 11-1.
Item 9F, Mr. Chairman, on the Project Pumpkin fee in lieu of tax agreement. I move for adoption at third reading and ordinance authorizing, one, the execution and delivery of a fee in lieu of tax agreement binding between Greenville County, South Carolina, and a company identified for the time being as Project Pumpkin, acting for itself, one or more affiliates, and or other project sponsors pursuant to which the county shall covenant to accept certain negotiated fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes with respect to the establishment and or expansion of certain facilities in the county and to other matters relating thereto. Mr. Chairman, I would move to hold this item in order for a public hearing to be scheduled.
All right, the item will be held on the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Item 9E, Project Blue Sky fee in lieu of tax agreement. I move for adoption in third reading. In order to authorize the execution and delivery of a fee in lieu of tax agreement binding between Greenville County, South Carolina, and Project Blue Sky, the granting of certain infrastructure tax credits to the company and other matters relating thereto. Mr. Chairman, I would move to hold this item in order to schedule a public hearing. All right, sir. Item 9H, Greenville County Anderson Multi-County Industrial Business Park Agreement Amendment, Project Blue Sky. I move for adoption at third reading in ordinance to amend an agreement for the development of a joint county industrial and business park, 2010 park of Anderson and Greenville County, so as to enlarge the park. And Mr. Chairman, I move to hold this item in order for a public hearing to be scheduled.
All right, I'm reminded we need to vote on these polls. So we have Project Pumpkin, Blue Sky, and the second Blue Sky. All in favor of holding these three on the floor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Voting unanimous.
All right, item 9I, Greenville Anderson Multi-County Industrial Business Park Agreement Amendment CH2M Hill Incorporated, I move for adoption at third reading in ordinance to amend an agreement for the development of a joint county industrial and business park, 2010 Park of Anderson in Greenwood County, so as to enlarge the park.
All right, any discussion? All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously.
Item nine J, Project Orange, fee in lieu of tax agreement. I move for adoption at third reading in ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee in lieu of tax agreement binding between Greenwood County and Project Orange, whereby Greenwood County will enter into a fee in lieu of tax arrangement with Project Orange and providing for payment by Project Orange of certain fees in lieu of federal taxes, providing for the allocation of fees in lieu of taxes payable under the agreement for the establishment of a multi-county industrial business park and other matters related thereto. Mr. Chairman, I move to hold this item in order for a public hearing to be scheduled.
All right, all in favor of holding this item on the floor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously.
Item nine K, Greenwood County Anderson, excuse me, Greenwood Anderson Multi-County Industrial Business Park Agreement Amendment, Project Orange. I move for adoption at third reading in ordinance to amend an agreement for the development of a joint county industrial and business park, 2010 Park of Anderson in Greenwood Counties, so as to enlarge the park. Mr. Chairman, I move to hold this item in order for a public hearing to be scheduled.
All right, all in favor of holding this, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously. Mr. Kirby, that may have been a record. It's a sign of all the economic development that's going on in Greenwood County. All right, ordinance is at second reading. Mr. Dill.
CZ 2015-61, property of Daniel W. Patterson, Sierra TPG LLC, located on Highway 14, requesting rezoning from I-1 to S-1. Planning Commission and the committee recommended approval.
Any discussion on this item? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously. Mr. Dill.
Property, that's a CZ 2015-62, the property of Stonemore, South Carolina, LLC, located on Woodruff Road, requesting rezoning from S-1 to R-12. Planning Commission recommended approval, and the committee recommended approval as amended. On behalf of the committee, I move for approval of the ordinance at second reading, and then I have an amendment.
All right, what is your amendment?
Amendment is to amend the zoning request to R-15, and this is at the applicant's request.
All right.
I move for approval of the amendment.
All in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, now the motion is.
I make a motion that we approve the ordinance as it's amended.
Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Dill, you said it was currently S-1. My information says RS.
RS.
Thank you, sir.
And it's asked to be R-12, but we're going to.
And we're just.
We amended it to R-15.
Yes.
Any other discussion? All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously. Mr. Dill.
CZ 2015-63, the property of Saluda LLC, located at 1625 South Highway 14, requesting rezoning from I-1 to S-1. Planning Commission and the committee recommend approval. On behalf of the committee, I move for approval at second reading.
Any discussion? All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed unanimously.
CZ 2015-64, the property of L&amp;L Enterprises of Simpsonville LLC, located at 404 Scuppletown Road, requesting rezoning from R-12 to OD. Planning Commission and the committee recommended denial. And on behalf of the committee, I move for approval of the ordinance at second reading.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Let's start with the public hearing when this was discussed, and there were a lot of citizens there from the community, and I got an opportunity to talk with the gentleman who wants to make the development there, build an office building. And there was discussion that if this was denied, he would come back with a planned office development concept. And everybody was in agreement that that would satisfy the property owners because of it would lay out how the property would be screened across their backyards and drainage would be provided for. And he'd be held to that under the POD zoning. So if we deny this tonight, I think we'll still get a good project out of it down the line pretty soon. And so I would ask it be denied. I'd vote for that too. And I think that'd serve the best interest of everybody involved.
All right. Any other comments? Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, if we deny this tonight, then is it, can't come back for a year?
It would be a new zoning.
It's been more restrictive.
Okay. Okay. Yes. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? All right. All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
And I think the intention was for the no's being unanimous.
CD 2015-65, property of Roy Lee McKee, located on Fairview Road, requesting rezoning from RS to RM10. Planning Commission and the committee recommend denial, and on behalf of the committee, I move for approval of this ordinance at second reading.
Any discussion? Glenn, are you?
I concur with the recommendations of both the Planning Commission and the committee, and request my colleagues to deny this request.
All right. All right. Any other discussion? All in favor, please say aye. Opposed?
No.
All right. Vote is unanimous. All right, item number six, Mr. Dill.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, CZ 2015-58, property of Archie L. Hornbore Trust and Simco Incorporated, located at 5320 Hornbore Drive, requesting rezoning from S1 to RS and then to RM. 11. The Planning Commission recommends approval, and the committee has no recommendation.
All right. Mr. Burns?
Yes, sir. Dr. Taylor, Ms. Kaiser, I've got my memorandum of. I have to abstain on this one because of a business conflict.
All right.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
Is this 58 or 54?
That's 58. It's 58. It says 58, but I'm wondering what happened to 54. I don't know. This is 58, though, Mr. Chairman. I move for adoption at second reading.
All right. Is there any discussion on this?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to share my thoughts with it because it's one that we've all heard a lot from the folks that live out in that community, and also from the folks proposing the development out there. It's a pretty large scale development, pretty complicated. And so, you know, there's a lot of things to consider on this one. I rode up there, rode through the neighborhood, rode down the streets here and yonder, and looked at all the information that has been presented and that I have received, and also comments from the citizens out there. And got to say, I'm a little bit conflicted. But my conclusion is that the scale of this development would actually change this neighborhood from a suburban area to a more urban area. And that kind of bothers me a little bit, even though the developers are promising to make what is reported to be almost $1 million in road and traffic signal improvements. But looking at their traffic studies, what I got out of it, the net effect would be about the same conditions afterwards as they are before, even though it would accommodate a lot more traffic to the area. then where does the problem go? If you don't fix it in a larger area, it may cause more problems to the next group of citizens on down one direction or the other. So that kind of bothered me about this a little bit. I think that urban neighborhoods need a street grid to diffuse the traffic in multiple directions. And I think this project is constrained a little bit by I-85 on one side. It has a creek running down the middle and some lowlands on the other side. And I think that even with the roads improved, which would be mighty nice, it might be a short-term fix, and I think that might compound the problem for the larger neighborhood out there. So I'm going to have to vote no on this.
Disaster if you voted in favor based on the fact that it would destroy our community, one of the last communities that Afro-Americans have in Greenville County. And actually, a lot of disagreement and frustration is with the Durham family. I knew the parents, that Durham's that purchased this land, and I'm just sure that they would, if they would be discouraged with that happening. Actually, Durham Drive is just a lane instead of a road. It's not wide enough to be a road. And then I'm really concerned about surrounding neighborhoods because of the time that these persons have lived in this area and the fact that they're in their senior years. And many of them have called me and asked me to vote against it based on that safety for these people who try to get to eating places there and visit neighbors, and their pace is slow and toddling, and this would be very much unsafe for them. So I would hope that my colleagues would vote no.
As Mr. Kirby stated, I spent a lot of time on this issue. I've certainly heard from a lot of the people that live in the area. I've gone to the area. I've met with the developers. I also had a long discussion with Fire Chief. And the $1 million worth of infrastructure improvements, including the moving of Hornbrier further down Darlington Road, double in, double out, and a stoplight. And the fire chief said that in itself is going to make a tremendous difference in the Darlington Road Pelham interchange. After studying the entire issue, looking at both sides, and looking at the county as a whole, and one other thing that hasn't been brought up, the property right now that is being asked to be rezoned to RM11 is currently zoned S1. When you look at what can be put out there under the S1 zoning right now, the impact on the community in general is going to be unbelievable, or could be, has that potential. Where, after studying everything, I will vote in favor of this issue.
All right, Mr. Payne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I understand what some of my colleagues have said. I think all of us are conflicted about what to do on this. There's no question that the current traffic problems are very difficult. And but as I look at the solutions, and I look at the potential for zoning, and it is true, what Mr. Kirby said, it's going to be changing. That intersection, that area is really, it is residential, but it has the potential to become a very urban area. Matter of fact, the land use plan calls for it to be a super regional center, which is a very big center. And when I look at the solutions that are being offered, where the developers are proposing to pay for the traffic changes to allow Pelham Road at Garlington to go from an LOS level of service of E currently, and under building with the project, but without mitigating conditions, it would go to an F. But with mitigating conditions, it goes to a D. So the level of service actually will improve, and I think that's in, that is long term. And then the other one, that's in the AM, and then in the evening, it goes from a D to a C. So again, there's an improvement. Now, so my feeling is this is a step to solve a problem that needs to be solved, and we need to approve this.
I too have visited that area, studied and talked with a number of people who live in that area. And in working with a lot of the elderly people who live in that area and the need to maintain their lifestyle, I would vote to no on this.
Some of it, but it doesn't solve a major problem or another major problem on the back end of this. We're dumping 15% of the people that live in the apartments will be going out the back gate or the back part. When we initially started talking about this, we were going to have only that entrance at the front with the traffic light, and then we would have an emergency gate at the back. Because part of this is under the floodplain, and also for fire, the other one is done. We changed that, and I think this, if we had kept that, then that would keep the cars from going out on Durham Road, Dublin Road, and also you have to have Shannon Lake Circle, and it's going to impact all of those houses from there over to Shannon Park Christian School. And unless the builder is willing to widen this road, this is about an 18-foot road. If you dump this amount of traffic, it's going to have a major impact on that neighborhood.
Sir?
I understood today we're going to have a case that all of us are in this table, and some of the audience might know what can happen in an S1. Now, we could say the owner of the property wouldn't dare sell it to people that would put something in there that's not going to be exactly what the community wants, but they don't have any choice. When we deny this rezoning, we're going to destine that community for what S1 will provide. Now, they want it that way. They want beer joints, they want nightclubs, they want platinum. They're against rezoning it.
less let them, if that's what you want to do. You know, but I tell you, I think that this is going to be good in the long run. Those roads are not gonna stay that way.
All right, any other comments? Call the question. All right, let's have a.
Roll call vote.
Roll call vote.
Taylor?
Yes.
Norris?
No.
Seaman?
Yes.
Gibson?
No.
Ballard?
Yes.
Corbin?
No.
Payne?
Yes.
Deal?
Yes.
Coffin?
Yes.
Meadows?
No.
Gates?
No.
Burns? Abstained.
Six in
favor, five opposed, one abstention.
Motion fails.
This is a amendment to the land use regulations on family subdivisions. I move for approval at second reading and ordinance to amend the Greenville County Land Development Regulations.
All right, if you wish to leave, please leave quietly with no talk until you get outside. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry, Mr. Deal, but I couldn't hear.
Well, I understand. I'll start over again, Mr. Chairman. The land use regulations amendment to the family subdivision. I move for approval at second reading and ordinance to amend the Greenville County Land Development Regulations as amended to exempt from the sundry plant requirements that conveyance of subdivided land to immediate family members.
All right, any discussion? Any discussion on the rest of the question? All in favor of the ordinance, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Pass unanimously. All right, ordinance at the first reading, Mr. Dill.
I present the first reading zoning docket CZ 2015-66 through CZ 2015-69.
All right, those will be sent to the Mr. Curtin.
Mr. Chairman, I present for first reading an ordinance authorizing under certain conditions the execution of delivery by Greenville County, South Carolina of a special source revenue credit agreement with Bosch Rexroth Corporation with respect to manufacturing, testing, and product proving grounds facility in the county whereby the project would be subject to payment of certain fees and lieu of taxes and whereby Bosch Rexroth Corporation will be provided certain credits against fee payments in reimbursement of investment in related qualified infrastructure and provided for related matters.
All right, it's not been financed yet.
Today.
All right, it'll remain on the floor for second reading. All right, committee reports. Mr. Kirby.
Okay, Mr. Chairman. Committee of the whole, the well to say, you want to go to the finance that we held from the committee that. The Finance Committee voted unanimously to approve the recommendation of the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee on the allocation of excess funds that were collected in the amount of $64,183.87. You were provided with a spreadsheet of all the applicants and principal recipients and the recommendation of the advisory committee and with the approval and endorsement of the finance committee. So I'll make the motion that we approve that on behalf of the finance committee.
All right, any discussion? Mr. Dill.
My concern is that we just voted tonight to give $500,000 for a park in the city of Greenville. We're giving all except two of the projects that have been allocated here are for city projects. A lot of us represent other places other than the city of Greenville. And I'm not understanding why we're not allocating money for projects and for benefits in the county. I mean, $500,000 in one swipe might not seem like a whole lot, but, and these other things are just nickel and dimes, but in comparison to the $500,000. But I would like to see us hold this and see if we can't get a better recommendation here. I'm not prepared. I didn't plan to introduce any change to this except to call attention to what it is. And I think we need to hold it and look at projects in the county, get them to recommend or for the staff, or we can among ourselves look at things out in the county that need to be done that we can spend the $65 million on. $65,000. I wish. If it did, we wouldn't be arguing about $65,000. But I would make that motion if we hope.
All right.
To the next meeting.
I certainly understand Mr. Dill's point. The only thing I got to point out is the only groups that we can give this money to are the ones that are on the sheet. We can't stray from that because they had to have applied for money. And when you look at it, the Fountain Inn's getting some, and Travel Rest Farmers Market's getting some, the Ups Country History Museum, and that was one other one I thought that.
Discover Up Country.
So there are some. I mean, there's only a few that you actually could, because they're on the sheet, that you could allocate those money. So I don't mind holding it for 2 weeks or whatever, that's until our next meeting. But this is the only list that we can choose to put the monies to.
Some of these projects we're giving to the second time in this one allocation.
All of them.
Well, have received your vote.
And I think that you need to look at this. But I just ask that we hold it.
Just one point. Not every application is actually on the sheet. Some are turned down because they do not follow the policies and rules and regulations that the accommodations tax can go to.
What I understand, this is the whole sheet. This is the list of everybody who applied for accommodations tax.
Everybody who applied and fit the vote. I know at least one that was turned down.
Didn't make it past the screen.
Qualified. Yeah, exactly.
These are all qualified. Good point. All right, any further discussion?
Yeah, there's one on it that we've turned down every year, and the committee comes back and puts on the review, and that's Broken Arms. And they, we turned it down the first time, and it seems that the committee really doesn't understand what the council is saying, is that they're not supposed to do that.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
And the committee questioned the advisory committee report pretty carefully on that, and they were pretty firmly in the view that these recipients were the most deserving, that under the county's policy and criteria that brings on-site visitors into Greenville County to spend their money.
Yeah, but the thing is, we also have a policy that it's not a pass-through, and that's what Metropolitan Arts is. We give the Metropolitan Arts, and then they pass it to someone else, and our policy is against that.
Well, I've heard that both ways. I'm not sure if that's accurate, but you might be right, I may be right.
But what's the deal? My motion will give us time to look at that.
I think they've always passed it through. Metropolitan Arts passed it through. It's very important to us.
That's their policy. But we haven't given.
All right, we're ready to vote.
I just want to make one comment. I understand exactly what you say when you say these projects are in the city and we need to do things in the county. The city is in the county, and they represent the heart of the county, and it is the main tourist attraction for the county. Most of the interests are. I think we ought to hold it. I'm going to vote to hold it and to continue the discussion. We just need to acknowledge it is a part of the county.
I'll agree with you, and Greer is also in the county.
That's right.
And Martin.
That's right.
All right.
To respond to what they mean, is that this is accommodations tax.
Right.
And this is county accommodations tax. The city also has accommodations tax. They don't share that with us.
Much more.
Much more, yeah, they get much more than more.
Good point, good point.
So that's just for us to remind them.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I would just say that perhaps we should just abolish the committee since we don't ever seem to take the recommendations. It's kind of a waste of their time to go through the exercise. I don't think we've yet ever taken the recommendation.
True.
I'm going to vote against Toll.
All right, ready to vote. All in favor of holding, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
All right, we had three noes, I believe, Mr. Kirwin, Mr. Seaman, and Mr. Bell. All right, so we'll hold it to our next meeting.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, committee, the whole report from tonight's committee, whole meeting. Refugee relocation resolution, Mr. Chairman. On behalf of the committee, I move for adoption a resolution declaring Greenville County Council's opposition to the relocation of refugees from the United States Refugee Resettlement Program in Greenville County and the rejection of state funds to assist in the program as amended.
All right, you've heard the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, passes unanimously.
From the committee, the whole is the board and commission appointment to the Airport Environs Planning Commission. On behalf of the committee, I move to elect the following by acclamation: Airport Environs Planning Commission, Van Swafford, from District 18.
Heard the motion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes unanimously. Mr. Kirwin.
Third and final motion from the committee, the whole, Mr. Chairman, tax increment district agreement. On behalf of the committee, I move to approve the proposed agreement for tax increment financing revenue distribution with the city of Greenville.
All right, any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
All right, that's one no vote, 7-1. All right, now we come to, do you have any All right, appearances by citizens for items not on the current agenda. Is there anybody signed up?
Our first citizen is Ed Paxton.
Ambulance takeover item coming to committee of the whole in May rather than going before public safety committee for bidding was your prerogative, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I got a question. Is this the same reason the alleged need for that $1.9 million crane was not bidded by the standing committee which we obtained chairs, or was it for some other reason? And then, in addition to that question, and I think the people have got a right to know, because things seem to be going through here with the speed of light sometimes, and at the last moment. Is that the same reason the administrator's proposal 16 spending budget was a council-created stampede designed to make, as council member Sid Gates said, the council administrator happy?
All right, next speaker, Ms. Cunningham.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Presley Stutz. I live at 129 Farm Mill Circle in Simpsonville. After watching what you go through tonight, you couldn't pay me enough. Dead my job. I feel they don't pay me enough either, right? I'm here to talk to you, ladies and gentlemen, about the Greenville Health System. I'm in favor of the health care that they give to the citizens of this county. As a matter of fact, my wife, who suffered with Parkinson's disease, was the very first patient that received a groundbreaking surgery that stopped her shaking. She literally went from this to she's now perfectly still. They offer very good health care. But I'm concerned about some of the decisions, some of the behind-the-scenes work that's been going on by the Board of Trustees to take the ownership of the hospital from the hands of the citizens of South Carolina and delegate it to a separate nonprofit board that would not be accountable to our South Carolina delegation, nor would it be accountable to the citizens of South Carolina. They've been working on this for well over a year. It's been very secretive, and I've concluded that it's illegal in many areas. And it sets a bad precedent, because as you know, the Greenville Health System is a political subdivision of the state of South Carolina. And if they can take as a board and vote in another board that will be the ultimate decision maker, we set a precedent for Clemson University, University of South Carolina, other institutions of higher learning in the state, as well as many other political subdivisions of this state. I'm very concerned because it's been very secretive. The public is just now finding out about this. It's very self-serving from the standpoint that this new board will be only accountable to themselves and not the current Board of Trustees nor the state delegation. It's bad for the citizens of Greenville County. We have a $2.1 billion plus asset in the Greenville Health System. And their proposal is to take this and to lease it out in one-year increments over the next 100 years for a minimal amount of money. It would then be controlled by a nonprofit organization that could have its headquarters in Chicago or Baltimore or Los Angeles, California, that would then dictate our hospitals. We all see that as institutions grow bigger and larger, the economies of scale and outreach. I'm afraid that this is going to increase the healthcare costs for the citizens of the upstate, as well as the quality of care. My time is up. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, Speaker, Ms. Kaiser.
Thomas, your letters.
Thomas.
I had a speech prepared, and I think I just, based on what the prior gentleman just said, tomorrow is a meeting between the GHS board and executives and some legislatures from the delegation, upstate delegation. This is a serious statewide situation that has come before us, because once GHS is taken, the whole body is taken, put into this new not private nonprofit, they will make it part of a statewide monopoly. That is their stated plan. From the south coast of South Carolina all the way up into western North Carolina, that is their stated plan in their own boardroom. So this is a very serious situation. The other situation is GHS has their own police force. They wanted to take over the EMS. They want to do everything for everybody. But they don't pay hardly any property taxes. They generate tons of money that goes into big salaries, like CEO Michael Rubin's salary of $1.3 million a year. This is a charitable nonprofit, and these people are making tons of money. They're not paying taxes. I looked up the tax record for GHS's main campus. Big massive campus over there. In fact, they have an app now, so you won't get lost there. They pay $73,000 in taxes. The tiny little Kmart next door pays $263,000 in taxes. And Kmart pays probably $800,000 in sales taxes. That's GHS. If you guys had the air tax property like normal businesses, you could provide the police for them in their own hospital. You could fill that gap that was in the EMS budget easily. It's time for GHS to be declared a for-profit company, is what they are, and they're trying to monopolize the whole state healthcare system. Healthcare costs have gone up 120% to $22,000 per family of four in the last 10 years. Inflation rate has been reduced to zero in the last 3 years, except they keep increasing prices. Chairman Jim Morton told me on the phone that when they buy, like the cancer clinic, they almost double their price to the patients. Every time they buy a clinic, they double the charges they get from Medicare. That is a for-profit company. They're not looking out for the citizens of Greenville County. They're not looking out for the patients. GHS management should be stopped. You guys need to get involved with this, and I would say that you definitely get involved with the tax situation, especially with property taxes. Thank you very much.
Our next citizen is Bang Paul on the Vietnamese Soldiers Memorial.
Good evening. My name is Bang Paul. I'm living on 5204 Three Spring Trail, Greenville, South Carolina, 21615. First of all, I would want to say thank you to all of you for the resolution of the immigration. That's a good news for the people. That shows that you care about people. I'm here to be honored to report that for 1 month already, I've been communicating with all the Vietnamese American community in the United States and Canada. And I'm so proud to tell them that we got yes from the county of Greenville for us to build a monument, the memorial monument for the Vietnamese and American soldier during the Vietnam War era. Many of you, I believe in your hearts, we have to say thank you to all the soldier, American soldier. But with the Vietnamese, we came from the country that we appreciate the good and the sacrifice of the Vietnamese soldier and the American soldier who died for us. You never really understand why, because we will not be able to stand here today to ask you to do this favor if we didn't have their lives and their sacrifice for us. Many of them came back home. Now, more than 40 years, it's almost a half of the century. We didn't do anything for them. So as I am one of the Vietnamese American, I would like to see the next generation that will become American Vietnamese, not the Vietnamese Americans anymore. They still can understand and love for all the American soldier who always give their life, their blood, and their youth for the people around the world, not just for us. And so therefore, I'm very proud to be American, and I would like to see, we're looking forward that to build the monument to show our appreciation to the American and Vietnamese soldier. Thank you very much.
You know, as we move into 2016, I like to look back at my previous goals to see the items that were achieved, goals that were adjusted for one reason or another, and to pay most attention to the goals I failed at. Did I fail at those goals because they are no longer one of my priorities, or because I simply did not give them the time and attention that they deserve? So, in thinking on the goals for No Kill in Greenville County, I went back to the budgets of previous years to see if the goals of animal welfare were getting the time and the attention that they deserved. But our statistical data from Animal Care show that the answer to that question is no. In 2011, Animal Care achieved a 90% or higher save rate by 2016. In 2013, Animal Care moved that goal to 2017. And in the upcoming fiscal year budget, that target has now been pushed off to 2020. Why? Why do we feel like Greenville is going to take longer to achieve this goal than any other community that has committed to achieve that? Maybe because we lack that key component of commitment. The statistics show that even though Greenville County has had a stated goal of no kill, that we have still been hovering around a 37 to 45% kill rate every year, even though our intake numbers have been consistently dropping for the past 3 years. That's 6,800 to 9,500 animals being killed every year at a facility that you have oversight on. Not talking about just the old and the injured or the vicious. I'm talking about the cute and cuddly. I'm talking about the well-mannered, the puppies, the kittens, the purebreds. In 2015, we have had intake numbers that have been down many months in compared to 2014. And even then, our kill rate is high. It's still going up. Part of the problem those statistics show me is that the Healthy Pet Foster Program was dropped this year. Those statistics also tell me that some bridges have been burned with the rescue organizations that have pulled pets from the facility in the past. But the main message that I get from those statistics is that Greenville County has not committed to the goals that they have stated. But there's hope, because people like myself and my colleagues are willing to continue to educate ourselves on how to help the animal welfare community and to make Greenville the best it can be. Not only for the animals, but for the pet owners, the volunteers, the shelter staff, the rescue organizations, because those are the ones that are working tirelessly in these efforts. I challenge you that instead of being a hurdle to overcome, that you become a support system for the animal welfare community in 2016. I hope you enjoy your holidays, and we'll be back in the new year.
Thank you.
But I didn't have my name called. That's okay. Dan Harbell.
Yeah, he didn't respond. So.
Oh, did I not hear my name called? I was in the back.
That was on the agenda, and you did not respond to
that. Okay. Thanks, sir.
Thank you. All right, the administrative report?
I have no report.
All right, request and motions. We will start with.
Mr. Chairman, I was here for the Veterans Day. I guess I know I'm talking in that I know that I am among the aged and the elderly, and I think about the veterans who died, when I think of the elderly as they walked out of there tonight. You know, and some of us sitting up here, you know, y'all kind of gray headed too. I'm beginning to realize that maybe Greenville needs to look at the needs of all of our people. I can say that because I know what my age is. And I know what some of your ages, you know, I know you have children, I have grandkids. I want them to have a good time. But I think you need to be a little bit more sensitive to the needs of our people to make sure that we try to do some of the things that we think of would be great for them. I just ask you to think about that and think about all of us. I'm living a good life. The Lord has blessed me, and He's going to bless all of us. Hope that we can smile back on some of the yes and the no's that we
wrote.
Thank you,
Ms. AC Tech.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Donaldson Field at SC Tech was honored to have been selected by the U.S. Secret Service to host Air Force Two last Tuesday as Vice President Joe Biden came to the upstate to address students, faculty, and other guests at Clemson University. And I want to also remind everyone of our annual city-county luncheon, which is going to be on December 14th. The Clemson One building, and the invitations are coming out this week, so be on the lookout for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gibson.
So, thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a question. I guess I have a concern for people from other counties presenting at our meetings, and I wonder if they are also presenting at their county meetings.
sensitive question. Maybe I'm not stating it right, but I'm all.
This has been a long night, starting a long time ago. I am proud to sit on this dais with my colleagues. We've shown those present and we've shown each other. We can disagree about things, we can discuss issues, we can come together when one of us can't represent our district. The rest of us step up and do the best we can to represent someone who can't do it, because we not only represent our own districts, but we represent Greenville County. And I just want to thank everybody for the fact that we can come together and work together. We can disagree, but in the end, we are all still representatives of Greenville County. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Kirby.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have two quick claims that I need some help with. And first one is neighborhood safety and speed control. I don't know about you guys in your district, but I've had several calls lately from citizens who live in subdivisions that are complaining that people are speeding too fast through those subdivisions. And in some cases, there's a lot of traffic cutting through those subdivisions as a shortcut to get from one major road to another one. And they're asking the county to put up some speed humps or whatever we think of to do that. And so our public works have gone out there and they set up the measure devices to check the volume of traffic and the average speed over a certain period of time. And in most of the cases here lately, the numbers haven't come up to what we've got on our books to justify the speed hump. So you have to tell those people that, well, I'm sorry, but we can't do anything to slow the cars down because it doesn't qualify under our policies. Policy may be reasonable, it may be the right way to go. But I'm asking if we could take a look at that and maybe see if we can work some flexibility in that policy to accommodate a case-by-case situation. Because one size doesn't fit all. And, you know, you hate the thought of kids playing in the front yard and chasing the ball out in the road and somebody getting run over. Last thing we want to think about there. So, you know, the policy is good, but we got to put some, apply it to a real life situation, I think, and maybe put a little flexibility in this. So I'd ask the administrator to get with our director of public works and maybe our traffic people, and any ideas that my fellow colleagues might have on that would be helpful too. The other thing I have right quick is recycling. We have a good system in Greenville County to people to take their household trash and all kind of items, and recycling is a big part of that. And you know, we got, I think, 13 unattended recycling containers all around the county now. And some of them, I guess most of them, have been by the permission of shopping centers and commercial properties to let the county put a container over on corner of the parking lot, and people can come to do their recycling, and that helps us keep trash off of our streets and roads and public places. And more people are recycling. I see them there all the time. But here lately, for example, on Woodruff Road at the Walmart down there, we've had recycling containers there for a good many years, but they got a new manager down there now, and they've let the county know through our public works and department that the new manager wants the county to get those things off of the parking lot area over the corner. So, you know, I can understand his point there too, but if you know of anybody who has allowed the county to put recycling containers on their property, express appreciation to them, thank them for that. And if you know of some places that need some containers, help us look for spots where people can allow that to the county to put those boxes there. The county comes and picks them up and replaces them with empty containers, and it's a public service. So I just wanted to ask y'all to think about that and maybe get a little help on that too. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Mr. Payne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've got one comment to make and then two requests, Mr. Chairman. One is, I was pleased to see the editorial in the Greenville News the other day that Mr. Kirkland wrote. I think most of us would agree, we're very pleased, very proud of what StatSource did. And we need to grow more companies like StatSource. From five men got together, I guess there were men, five people got together here in Greenville, a small area, and they have over 1,000 employees now.
2,100 worldwide.
Excuse me?
2,100 worldwide.
2,100 worldwide, but anyway, significant. We need to grow our own headquarters, and that's a great example. So thank you, Mr. Kirkland, for that editorial. The two requests, Mr. Chairman, are that we have a report at Cal. What Ms. Seaman said is so true. We may well do away with the ATAC group if we're not going to listen to what they have to say. And maybe instead of them reporting to the Finance Committee, they could just report to the Committee of the Whole. We could ask them questions and have that discussion in that session, maybe even the next time. If we're going to hold it and consider it, maybe we could bring it to the Cal meeting, Committee of the Whole meeting. And, I mean, their representatives, I was just looking at their letter, two large hotels, one small hotel, one restaurant, one cultural organization, one at-large, and one CVB chair. They're qualified people to know how we ought to spend that money. And so we ought to be able to answer their question, maybe to communicate our message. Try to find places outside of cities that they can fund. But anyway, that's one. And the second request is, and I made this before, but my understanding is there was a great report that Ms. Gucker's area did on the integration of Greenville water systems, freshwater, sewer, and stormwater systems, and or wastewater, I guess you call sewers wastewater. I want to hear what they did in that report, and I think the Cal would be a good place to provide that to us. Thank you, sir.
All right, Mr. Dillon.
I don't know if you people have started getting any emails and phone calls from people who've gotten their tax notices. If you haven't, just go ahead and get relaxed. Sit back next to the telephone and next to the computer because they're coming. I've had a bunch of phone calls, people are quite upset. And now the deadline, if, I know Mr. Hansley was going to let me know when the deadline is for, I'm understanding it's Thursday. Is there no room for appeals?
Deadline for what?
State law. State law, it doesn't give us any room.
No, sir, it's been open for about 90 days.
If people don't appeal by Thursday, that means what?
They can appeal next year.
They have to. They won't affect this year, they'll have to go to next year.
Yeah, what they're appealing is their value. Tax rates are set, so it would be appealed to that.
And that won't happen until next year, if they don't do it by Thursday. They got the letter, and it didn't mean anything. It said it wasn't a tax notice, so they looked at it, and they, well, that doesn't look too bad. But then when they got the dollar and cents numbers this week, they said, "Oh, me, I didn't know my tax is going to go up $300. Woo, I should have done something." Well, we got problems, people. But you know, it's not one that we hadn't dealt with every time we do a reassessment.
You know, the dollar amounts paid to each entity is now displayed.
Oh, yeah, the back one last year, too. That is wonderful. I saw the, on mine where I gave, going to give the school district a sizable amount to educate many children. But, Mr. Chairman, I want to do one thing. I've noticed something, and I don't know if you've noticed it or not. But since we've been in this room, they've been three men standing. You see these three officers? I would like for us to acknowledge their faithfulness. heroes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm clear.
Mr. Ballmer.
I'd just like to tell everybody that Monday I was at White Horse Road again, and everybody was complaining. Defendants, attorneys, judges, and court personnel, and I just wanted to remind everybody of that particular situation. I would like for the council members to go by there sometime and see what Greenville, the judicial system that Greenville County provides its taxpayers.
Yes, sir. This gives an ask a question about people outside the county speaking. I do know one tonight who spoke that does have property here and as well as outside now.
But they have property.
Yeah, and we don't always know that, and I just happen to know some of those that spoke tonight that that was the case. Also, in Berea, this past Saturday, we had the first fall festival that we've had on the Swamp River Trail. It's the Pocket Park, and it was quite successful. We had vendors there, good attendance. There will be, the next event will be on December 5th, so you might mark that on your calendar. If you need Christmas gifts or that type of thing, we certainly invite you to come by and visit with us.
All right, Dr. Taylor.
Yes, sir. As you know, the state of South Carolina found $1.3 billion just laying around somewhere that they lost. So I assume that they're going to help us with the local government funds to kind of beef it back up. So maybe a resolution is in order to encourage them to give us our money back.
Just be sure Senator Leatherman has it in hand.
Yes. Had a new road down to Myrtle Beach.
I just wanted to comment on Mr. Kerwin's situation with people speeding in the neighborhood. I've had that happen in my district several times. One man called me and I said I promised him I would get the sheriff to put some patrolmen out there. And then later about something, he said, oh yeah, I remember you. I got the sheriff out there for you. And he said, yeah, it cost me $75.
He got off cheap. Good for sure.
Just one thing, can we get maybe a schedule of capital project? I know, because one of the things somebody's asked me about was the rec projects, both the new projects and some of the refurbishments or ongoing maintenance projects that are in the rec district. Can we get maybe just a line item schedule of when those can start and stop? And
yeah, we'll get the ones that we currently are working on with the objective that
right.
Start and change. So it'll be a continual
effort. What's going on right now and when they're expected to start, stop? If we're in planning phase, when does construction start, stop? And that's it. So with that, I move to adjourn.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.